Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Andy Seki and welcome to the show. Today we have a very special guest. His name is Kevin Hogan. We actually know each other a long, long time ago, about 20 years, I think, was the first time I discovered you, Dr. Kevin Hogan. So welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Andy. It is good to be here today. It's nice to be here. And I've, you know, it's funny. I've always wanted to come to Romania. And I just didn't think it was going to be by video.
Yeah, well, it's a start, isn't it? So let's set an intention in terms of creating the opportunity for you to also come here in person. I would love to show you around. But before that, let's start by presenting a little story of you. So you are the expert in influence and persuasion. You've written I don't know, 30 books or so. You are going to tell us the exact number.
Okay, guys. So here's the story. This is the short version, all right? The short version goes like this. Born in Chicago in a pretty rough neighborhood. And we grew up, my first stepfather had two stepfathers. One boy, what a mess. Family life was difficult. We had many children in a little teeny living space. And I was the oldest, so early on, very early on, I was working. From age 7 was my first job, 7. And then I slowly started working. My first business job was actually McDonald's, where I didn't work for myself. That was age 11. And that's how it was in those days. That was a long time ago. And time went on, and I learned how to sell. I learned how to sell greeting cards. I learned how to sell my services to cut somebody's lawn. I learned how to shovel snow. I learned how to do pretty much anything I could do to make money. And all of it required me going and knocking on the door and saying, "Hi, my name is Kevin. I would like to shovel your yard. I would like to pull your weeds. I would like to cut your lawn." And people started to say yes, as I learned how to ask better, as I learned to ask more efficiently. And I was like, oh, I get it. So by the time I was 12 years old, I was actually contributing to the family. It was just my mom and me, and all of my brothers and sisters were younger. As time went on, I went into the university. When I went to university, I studied nonverbal communication, and I'm telling you, I was hooked right there, nonverbal communication. There was only two books on influence at the time, and there were only two books on nonverbal communication. That's it. Ed Hall and Paul Ekman were the guys who were at the university. And then there was Cialdini and Roger Dawson, and that was it on the other side. So these guys kind of were my heroes, right?
Right.
So I studied this. Andy, I studied and I studied, and I was like, this is all so cool, but I know there's more. So as time goes on, I'm still in business for myself as a young guy. I'm still selling advertising. I'm still running national nonprofits, doing fundraising work for them, making their presentations better, making money for everybody except for me.
You were self-employed at the time?
Huh?
You were self-employed at the time?
I was. Oh, God, yes. Yeah, almost all my life. I think, who would hire me? I wouldn't hire me. I don't want to work for me. That's no fun. So yeah, I've had a few real jobs too, but only enough to know that I
go for that for myself also. Right? Very hard for me to. I wouldn't hire myself. I agree with that. Yeah.
Too much work, bad attitude issues sometimes. But so I was in business almost all the time for myself, and then about 1990, I started to realize that. I mean, I always liked Cialdini's work, so don't get me wrong, but. As I started to study influence more and I started to observe humans behave and how they would respond to me and to the request for money, I started to realize, you know what? There's stuff that's missing here. Like there's a lot of stuff that that Doc hasn't written about. And so I started to write The Psychology of Persuasion in 1990. Do you know how long ago 1990 is? That's 30 years ago. I was only 1 year old. So I start writing Psychology
plus
of Persuasion.
VAT. Plus VAT, Kevin.
Oh, that's it. So I start writing Persuasion. I finish it in 1.5 years. It's a big book, and it had a lot more stuff in it than got published. But I was happy with the final product. It took 5 years. Here's the hard part, guys. It took 5 years to get the book from being written to accepted to published to on the street. 5 years in the U.S., and that means I got turned down 247 times. Yeah. Kevin, you're not a good writer. You can't write. You don't have any talents. You're not any good at this. You don't know English grammar. forget a foreign language. And, you know, so I was like, look, this is a good book. I got it. I know it's a good book. I finally got Pelican Publishing, Zig Ziglar's publisher, to publish it in 1995. It took a while. When they published it, it took 1.5 years to sell the first 10,000 copies. After the first 10,000 copies, I was called by the New York Post, and the New York Post asked me to observe the president's body language, President of the United States body language, to see if he had had an affair with an office intern, right? You remember this?
I know the story. And
I watched it.
Amazing.
And I was like, I'm pretty sure. And I hit rewind, kept watching over it. Like, oh my gosh, I did not have a sexual relationship with that woman, Monica Lewinsky. He's a left-handed guy. That's my right hand. And this is what he did. If I'm really upset with somebody, I'm not going to go with my weak hand, my non-dominant hand. I'm not going to say this, right? I'm going to do it here with my dominant hand, with worse powers. Like, no, I didn't do that. Of course I didn't do that. That's what I wanted to see. And so I gambled a little bit and I said, Rita, you can quote, Dr. Kevin Hogan says, President of the United States did indeed have a sexual affair with that woman, Monica Lewinsky. And came out on the front page of the New York newspapers the next day. Day after that, it never stopped. It just, every single day was a newspaper somewhere in the world. The book then got published everywhere on planet Earth. It was 37 languages, I think it was, within 1 year. And the rest, as they say, is history.
Two questions, Kevin. Two questions before making it all history. Question number one would be, you are kind of waiting for that moment, but not waiting, but preparing all the time. Is that fair to say?
So of course.
You are like, how many, let's say, hours per day you obsessed with this topic?
Oh.
I'm just curious.
You know what this is a great question. And nobody ever asked this question. This is the key too. Every single day, I did three things every single day. I interviewed with somebody on radio, somebody on television, somebody at a newspaper. And I was working with my publicist every single day for free, for nothing, all the time. And so I was getting, literally my name was getting out there and people were like, oh, that Kevin Hogan guy, I know him. Yeah, he's all right. He's not bad. You know, and pretty soon people started to like me and they're like, you know, you should get Kevin Hogan on your show. You should get Kevin Hogan. You should get Kevin Hogan. Pretty soon Kevin Hogan became Kevin Hogan.
So the reason I'm asking this is because I notice nowadays there is a kind of a current brought about by marketers and the internet. And I would like your opinion on that because a lot of people are saying, 30 days to success, you know? In 30 days, you can build a following. In 30 days, you can do this. You can become an expert on Zoom in 30 days. And 30 days seems to be like the modern day mantra. And I'm laughing like you when I'm hearing 30 days, because 30 days could be the last 30 days after the three years, maybe. So what's your take on this type of offerings, 30 days to build the followership?
It's not real. These are the same people that say it takes 21 days to change a habit. And here's, you know, this all goes together, this whole thinking process. It's like, you know, fortunately, God gave us these amazing brains, and they really are pretty good. But you have to realize that whatever's been wired in for 30 years, say you use 30 years, it's not going to go away because we make a new habit. We simply have a new habit and the choice of going back and doing the old one. But now we have choices. So when it comes to success, I mean, guys, here's the deal. You have to be real. Never get disappointed that even after I was really well known in 1999, by the time, I mean, millions of people knew who Kevin Hogan was in 1999. Everybody, I mean, it felt like everybody. It wasn't, but a lot of people did. But even then, even once everybody knows who you are, you still have to do those three things every single day. You still have to get the interviews and do the work and write the books. I wrote 24 books in the next 18 years. 24 books in the next 18 years. That's a lot of writing. And yes, success is there. Here's a secret that nobody knows and will do the math on for you, guys. There are 2 million brand new books in the world this year from last year. 2 million. They will sell almost 1 billion copies. Now, let's do the math real quick. A, that's good because we love books. Books are back in business. That also means that for those 2 million copies, the average person will sell 500 books.
Which in Romania would still be good, actually, Kevin, you know? By the way.
Well, and that's true too.
Yeah, I want to take advantage of this moment to say I actually have written 15.
That's a lot of books, man.
They're all in Romanian, so my next book will be in English. But I want to tell you, to show you the shortest book I ever wrote in my life. And it's my first stories book for children.
What is it? What's the title there? What's the title? Is it?
It's a game on words. It is the Acorn School.
Oh, I like Acorn. That.
Right?
I get it. I like it. Yeah. Oh, that's really nice.
It's beautifully...
Holy cow, look at that.
The drawings are quite... They're not my drawings, as you can tell. But anyway, it's
That's beautiful. You know, and it's so hard too when you break. Was this your first book or is this your most recent?
No, this is my most recent. So it's my 15th.
So guys, here's the deal. Don't think that you're going to write a book that's full color photography or images or artist on every single page. This costs so much money to produce this.
So we almost make nothing out of the margin of it, but it was so fun. So it took me 2 hours, right? I just had an idea one night. And now we have almost 1,000 readers in
is that right?
2 weeks. Because of the 1st of June is the Children's Day, you know?
Oh, I like that.
We are recording this before the Children's Day. But let's go back to your book because I have something else to show you. This book is the persuasion book that I
read.
And it has a lot of inspiration from you.
Is that right?
It has a lot of inspiration from you. And especially the fact that when you write, and I want to go back into that subject of writing. When you are writing, Kevin, you have two things that inspired me. Number one is scientific proof. Mm-hmm. So you bring, and I really want to talk about this subject because a lot of books are written just kind of, I'm telling you this, you know, I have experience, let me tell you. And you don't do that even if you do have the experience, but you put the experience and you put the scientific proof. And I kind of copied that. I thought it's really neat to have that.
I like the system. It's because as especially as we get, you know, when we live life, we do learn a lot in life. We learn what works and doesn't work for us, right? We learn how things work and don't work for us. But what I learned as I started to teach people and to train people, when I started doing classes back in the middle 90s, right as the psychology of persuasion was coming out, I realized that not everybody thought like me. I realized not everybody did business the way that I do. And I was like, oh, so my way is not the only way. Very interesting. So, and this was actually really important because that's when I looked at Cialdini's six principles initially, I thought, oh, that's cool. I'm not sure I understand that one. I'm not sure if I believe that one, but I actually went and tested everything. And then I found the rest. I mean, now we have a list. We have 62 now. We're up to 62 and we're printing it this year at the end of the year. I'm really super excited. Wow, this is going to be so crazy. Fun. But anyway, guys, the deal is you want to write from your experience. You do, because people can relate to you. But if you don't have, like, if there isn't honest to goodness evidence that what you're saying is correct, then you're just full of, there's so many people out there that God told me to write this, Andy. No, he didn't. You were drinking too much that night is what the deal is.
My luck is the fact that I've been a journalist for 3 years almost. And when you are a journalist, people teach you to kind of validate from three sources. And your own experience is good, validated from science, and then validated by teaching other people to do it and see how they do it. I think there are kind of three good stools for the table, so to speak, you know?
Yeah, and if you want, telling the stories of the people that you teach is always helpful too. I've found this treasure, like a just huge treasure of all the people that I've gotten to have a little hand in their world. You know, maybe in mentoring or in working with them, consulting, coaching, and just watching them. I've watched people bypass me and just blow me away. Like, wow, how did that, you know, we've got one woman, Tanya Ryman, who's one of my favorite people in the world. And she came to class. She was homeless. She was out of luck. They had nothing. And she said, I spent my last dollars to come and see Kevin Hogan in 2004 in Las Vegas. And she ended up on national television every Tuesday on Fox News for 7.5 years. And she's still the number one body language expert in the world.
Wow. So the disciple cut speeds, and the mentor is looking and applauding. That's we have a saying like that in Romania.
I love it. I'm a little irritated, but I love her very much, and I'm so proud of her. And I think it's great. They call her first, and then they call me second. I'm like, ah, whatever.
And it's actually okay to have those two feelings together, right? So it's not like they cancel each
other. It's totally fine. It's because we should all be, you should always trying to be the best. You should always trying to be the most accurate, the most efficient, the best at it. And I would rather be the best than the most popular, actually. And I also like the most loyal fans as opposed to a billion fans who just stop by once in a while. So
totally agree.
Do you want hamburgers or do you want steak? Okay, that's part of the deal too. You can make a lot of hamburgers, or you can have some steaks that are really awesome. I'd rather deal with the best people in the world.
You hit perfectly for my question and thinking, because I don't know if you're aware of the book Small Giants by Bo Burlingham. I thoroughly recommend that book because it is
small
about
giants. Okay.
Small giants. Bo Burlingham is a columnist for different economic magazines, and he wrote that book looking at 14 examples of companies that refused to be bought by giants. So they remained small giants to serve their community because their owner's belief was that it's actually better to keep their culture and to keep the reason why they are doing what they are doing. And it's a bit like the steak analogy when you have, no, we do steak in that particular way. So one example comes to mind, that there is a company that only does 100 pairs of trousers per year, leather trousers.
Wow.
But Cheryl
Crow, that's the idea, right?
Is one of their clients, and they're crafting the trousers and they're making the trousers fantastic. And I fully agree. Those 100 clients are for sure happy clients.
No doubt.
Yeah.
No doubt.
Loyal.
And Prestige, this is the name of one of the two books I'm working on this year, is Prestige Persuasion. And it's really important that we find that group of people that we can be the most valuable to. And so as people think about success, yeah, you know, you've done the big audiences, I've done the big audiences. It's a lot of fun, guys. Don't ever think anything other. It's a blast. But the reality is that the most rewarding thing comes from the group of people that you sit with in your suite or wherever you'd work with your group and get the stories every, I meet with my people quarterly, but you know, four times a year. Mm-hmm. We talk every month, we talk all the time, you know, but I love the stories. I love to hear people. I love people say, Kev, what do you think? You know, I'm making $250,000 a year. Do you think I should switch my job and now go over here and do this instead? I love those heart pounders. Like, oh my God, if she doesn't succeed, I'm in trouble. Right. And I say, Rhonda, go ahead and do it. Now she's doing $450,000 a year, just ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And I'm so excited. I watch these people do great and it makes me feel better. And it's really important that your listener, in order to be influential, you really have to want the other person to do well. You know, you want Andy, if I'm working with Andy, I want Andy to like be my best supporter. I want him to go, oh, Kev, really go for it, man. Get it. I want to tell your story. You know,
it's fully agree. And also I think it's important to realize that this goes with the book. This goes with on stage presence. This goes online. So the principle stays the same. Is the way you express it that differs, isn't it? So right now, when I talk to you, I have the impression that we really want to help the audience. It's not like, it's virtual world. Nobody actually is paying a lot of attention. No, people do pay attention. They are listening to the tone of voice. They are looking at the body language, at the enthusiasm and all these little things. Do you find that people also notice your cues via virtual world like we are communicating right now?
People, they do. And you know, when you're on video like this on Zoom, it's important that there's a lot of ways people can choose to do a Zoom communication with people. And this is going to continue to be popular because this crazy world that we're living in right now is not going to change overnight. All right. It changed overnight to get here, but it's not going to change overnight to get back. All right. It's going to be different. So it's important that people learn to use their hands. It's okay. Okay. It's okay to come a little closer. It's okay to back up a little bit. And it's because we have distance. Distance is important. If I just sit back here like this the whole time, look at this. It's like, well, there's Kevin, right? We're comfortable, but this does not feel very friendly to me. It feels very, very, So tell me, Jeff, what do you think about the business that you're talking? Now, if I come up here and I talk with you, all of a sudden you can see that behind this Svengali little thing here, it's like there's actually a pretty happy person that wants to see people do really well. Yeah. And so we have to learn to gesture on camera, and we have to learn to occasionally use our hands, occasionally use our face. We have to get better with our eyes, with how wide we open our eyes. It forces us to be better. And so by being better now, we will be way better in 6 months when we're outside half the time and home half the time.
I agree. I want to circle back into the book writing, and then we will move to another subject that I'm very curious in. But the book writing is actually, to me, very important. I've written a bunch of books myself. I think you are getting actually closer to 30. I don't know. I have this number in my head. You are getting closer to 30. So it's 26 this year. Will be 26.
It'll be 27 actually at the end of the year, but yeah, there's
so, yeah.
One fiction and two nonfictions this year. I have extra time.
Yes.
And you're working on 17. That's a lot. You guys have no idea how much 17 books is. That's an insane amount of information.
So let me ask you about your writing process. There has to be a process. I mean, maybe people believe that we kind of get hit by an idea and we just start writing it. It's not all the time that way. So a couple of questions. How long it takes you to write a book? How do you go about researching? And what is your routine? You are writing in the morning, you are writing in the evening. What is your preferred kind of ecosystem for writing?
Okay, so a few secrets here. I'm going to show you something here, all right? This is one book right here that I'm working on right now.
It's huge.
This is massive. This is 700 pages. 700 pages. This is the material that I wrote. I will make this into 300 pages because I will put all of these pages, all of these sheets on the floor, all the chapters, and I'll say, I don't like that one. If it's not a 10, it won't go in the book. So I'll look at it and I'll go, what do you think? No, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, yes. And so this is the end of process right here. It takes about a month to do this process, to go through and reread and think, is there anybody who has something better than this out there? If Jonah Berger or one of the other guys is doing better than me on it, I'm not going to put it out there. I'm not going to be second best to anybody. So it's going to be the best that I have to offer. So this is one thing. So you always write. If you're not writing fiction, if you're writing nonfiction, you write way more than you're going to use, okay? For the Invisible Influence book, which came out about 7 years ago, I think it was 250 pages approximately, and we had about 500 pages on the floor. We had twice as many chapters, and boy, nine months it took me to write the book, 9 months, and generally that's about, now I'm just gonna give you an average. Mondays and Tuesdays and Wednesdays are sort of like book writing day. Saturday and Sunday is coffee with Kevin Hogan, which is an e-zine that I've had for 17 years, I think.
Very well. I read that piece every week, probably, sometimes not entirely, but I read it for 10 years, I think. So thank you.
And this is a good thing too. The concept is that you guys out there, it's really important that you stay in touch with the people who are, I always say the people who bought lunch today for me are the people that do business with me. And this is my way of sort of giving back, because we don't charge for the subscription. It's there all the time. People can literally for a lifetime read and learn a ton of material that they apply. I have more people. Go ahead.
There are hundreds of articles on your website. I think many, many hundreds, maybe close to, you're getting closer to 1,000 maybe.
Almost 1,000 right now, yeah. We've got about 4 million words right now on the website.
That's a lot of words.
So people can keep turning pages. And it's fine. I want to hear their story too. I don't. If somebody doesn't need to be a customer or a client, that's okay. It's like, utilize the material. Make me happy. Go and say something good about Kevin Hogan. Say, you know what? That man's a crazy man. But boy, is he fun. And he helped my life. That's cool. I'm happy with that.
Did you ever have a writer's block in your writer's career?
No, not really. No, I because the way that I write is a little different. I, I sit there and I'll look at something like on television. If I'm watching Friends, like for an old TV show, I'll say, now, how did Ross get Rachel back? How could he have done it better? How could he have done it differently? Everywhere I look, I see an opportunity. Like, how did the guy build the window? There's this beautiful window that I'm looking through. It's huge over here. Like, and I'll sit there and how did I do that? And how is that like life? And so I'll say, how is it similar? And I use questions to sort of trigger everything that I do. So sometimes I come up with ideas that are not so great. And other times I get what I call a Paul McCartney moment. Paul McCartney. It's like when you wake up in the morning and you're hearing the song, he heard the song one day, 1964, scrambled eggs, my, my, my. He's got great legs. My, 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 she's got great legs. Oh, how I love those scrambled eggs. And he took it to John Lennon, and John said, I don't like that song, Paul. That's terrible. And so Paul took it back home, and he wrote, yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. There's a shadow hanging over me. Yeah. Oh, I believe in yesterday. So the only way you get a Paul McCartney moment where you have creative genius is when you do a whole bunch of things that don't work first.
Fully agree. So you kind of embrace the idea of having bloopers because you transform those afterwards. And you also have a mechanism in the end by putting the pages on the floor. You know it will go away anyway based on your own standard. What I think is very funny is that when you write, you let yourself in the flow. But when you put pages on the floor, you take the scissors, the editor's scissors. So it's a different state, isn't it?
Painful.
I agree. It's a different hat, so to speak.
It is. It's not my favorite either. I don't like taking my own material that I've spent months writing and saying, that's just not a 10, you know? And the thing is, there's other people who will describe it better from a research perspective. There's other people who maybe can tell a better story. But I found my niche, right? I found my way of writing. And I had, you know, just like you did in Romania, you have a group of people that love the way that you write. They follow you because of how you write, because of how you communicate your ideas. And you don't need to be like anybody else. And the person who's watching you shouldn't actually strive to be like your style. They should develop their own style. And then they should do some of the things you've done. Write every single week or make video. Video is great, by the way. I do like video, but there's a lot to be said for writing. Text is still the best way to transmit information from person to person and have it recalled.
Structure. The structure in writing. So I know you're friends with Jeffrey Kittimer. So you've been to Romania, and he gave an interview in one of the newspapers, and it struck me like a ton of bricks because he said, I write to structure my mind. And I thought that's such a profound idea, isn't it? You don't not only write for other people or to be appreciated, but you write because it structures mind.
You're teaching yourself too when you're doing all the research and the work. And Jeffrey, I love Jeffrey. He's one of my best friends. And, you know, I talk about Jeffrey every now and then because he's about 15 years older than I am. So he's always pushed me. We would always meet in Las Vegas or something and he'd say, so kid, how you doing? I was like, Jeffrey, I'm doing really well, man. I'm making, and then 20 years ago, I'm making $10,000 a speech. He's like, not bad, kid. I'm at $25,000. And then I see him 3 years later in Vegas. We're sitting playing again. How you doing, kid? I'm like, I'm making 15 now, Jeffrey. He says, not bad, 35. I'm like, Jeffrey, I'm never going to catch you, man. You know, but he kept pushing and poking. And the thing is, he always asked questions. And it was Jeffrey that said, he said, Kev, what's the most important? He wasn't asking me for an answer. He was asking to see if I knew the answer. He says, kid, so what's the most important thing in selling? I was like, oh, Jeffrey, I hate these questions from you. God, don't do that to me. We're at a blackjack table, right? It's like in Caesar's palace. I'm like, don't do this to me. I said, I don't know. What's the most important thing in the selling? And he says, asking questions. Two words.
Yeah.
Asking questions. And I've used that ever since that in 2002, that conversation, I've learned to ask great questions. And so, that's what makes greatness, yeah.
Yeah, let me give you a little game on words, but based on what you just said. So speaking of questions, let me ask you a question about speaking.
Okay, deal. Good, go ahead.
So my question of speaking, moving into doing a transition into the public speaking realm, because you are a professional speaker, I want to uncover a little story that I'm telling on stage about you. I'm telling on stage this story. I told it for 10 years now. So, you know, when I teach the law of reciprocity, I tell the story of the big box I received from Kevin Hogan. Because when I became certified by you for the Psychology of Persuasion seminar that you have, you sent a big box, right?
It's true.
First is the first impression. I'm like, I was waiting, I was expecting two books, one manual, and maybe a CD or something. Why do I get this big box? But then I learned about the first impression, and I realized that the big box has a purpose to it. And then I discovered inside the box the expected materials, but six CDs on professional public speaking. I will never forget that in my entire life. Those six CDs on professional speaking started my public speaker's career.
Is that right?
So I'm telling you with a deep gratitude right now, because I was kind of playing with that idea in my head, but it was like the year 2000 or 1999. Mm-hmm. And I was like, public speaking, I fancy doing that, but how do you go about it? And those six CDs were the starter kit for me, because it was very tactical. It was explaining details. So it's an expert from your bigger course, right? The public speaking.
Exactly. Our goal was when we did the licensee program, we wanted people to train the material. We wanted the material to be trained accurately. In other words, this is what Kevin Hogan said, because I hate being misquoted. That's the first thing. Mm-hmm. So that was it. And then we had to, but what nobody else does is nobody else actually shows people, how do you go out and get an audience? How do you actually like develop a following? How do you actually serve people to where they want to work with Andy versus the guy next door? Because there's always competition everywhere. And so one of the things that we wanted to do, we did two things, I think, fairly well, which is we over-deliver. And I really believe in over-delivery at a very high level.
Yeah.
You know,
I fully agree. So I was listening to those CDs. Usually people buy a material, listen to it once or twice. I think I listened to those six CDs about 10 times at least.
That's smart.
That's the way to go about learning a material, actually, to be honest.
That was about 10 years of experience that went into that. And I think we pulled it out of the professional speaker course. And we still offer that course today. It's improved. It's better. We have better, faster strategies. But not 30 days, guys. I can't make anybody a professional speaker in 30 days. We can get you all. We can get you ready in 30 days, but we can't get you. No, that's so all that stuff is ridiculous.
Let's dig into that, Kevin. If somebody wants to learn public speaking at a professional level, if you were to give, like, again, the ecosystem of going about it, what would be the most important pieces of the puzzle, so to speak?
I think this is sort of a self-serving answer at first. I think the first part is you really have to work with somebody who's done it. I had a great mentor, Elsa Meldridge, and I talk to him still about once a month. And now I tell him how to run his business. He's 84 years old, guys. And he's a public speaker too. And he won't quit. He'll never quit. He'll never die. He'll live longer than I will. And I love this man. He taught me sort of stuff like Kevin, did you contact a radio station today? You know, all the things. So it's a question of getting you get your audience, you want to capture your audience. Hang on. I've got two lines of thought going in my mind. Where were we going again with this?
It's about what is the ecosystem of becoming a public speaker? So the pieces of the puzzle, so to speak.
Right. That's where I was so messed up. Okay, so let's go over here first. So first you have to learn your material. That's the number one thing. So get the material. You want to think of, like, why are you delivering this? Like, what makes you believe? You should be able to answer these questions for somebody. What makes you believe that you are the right person to deliver this material? Okay, that's the first thing. So when people start, they often tell information in store. I don't like this. I don't like when they tell a story of Henry Ford or somebody from 150 years ago. You know, I mean, I like to hear stories about successful people, Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. But here's the deal. Those people got wealthy with a much different strategy and arc than what most people are going to do. Their arc was developed on building a like a country almost, you know, like that is their entire life. They don't have a, they don't focus on the wife. They don't focus on the kids. They don't focus on their friends, their family, their own heart and things like that. And so you have to sort of weigh who you want to be. That's another puzzle. It sounds like it's really simple, but it's really hard though. Somebody, who is it? Andre Batko, 20 years ago, we were doing an event in Poland, and he came up to me, he says, Kevin, he says, you're as good as Tony Robbins. Why aren't you Tony Robbins? I said, because Tony Robbins doesn't see his wife and kids. You know, it's like, I love my kids. Like, I'm going to see my kids forever. And whatever happens around my kids on top of that is cool. Okay. Mm-hmm. So my goal was to be able to be, I need both pieces. Not everybody does. Not everybody has to have that, but I have to have that. Mm-hmm. So you got to know who you want to be. Like, who do you really want to be? Because believe me, if you want to be whatever this is, you can be there, but you don't need to be a billionaire to have fun. It's not necessary. I do.
That's tweetable.
You can be a millionaire and be just fine. I promise. I mean, I got to hang out in Europe about 40% of the last 4 years, 40% of the months. I've traveled all over and I live just fine, you know, and you can do what you want. And it's good to have a hero too. And when you pick a hero, you should pick a hero, not just because they're wealthy or successful, but who they are as a person. And you should think like, you should respect them and go, you know what? I'd kind of like to be like that person in some ways, you know, because this person has these characteristics or these traits that are important for me. And Elsom, for me, my mentor was like, he was such a good mentor. I knew he loved me already and he wanted me to do well. And he would say, Kevin, he says, do you know who Joe Vitale is? I'm like, I don't know who Joe Vitale is. He says, he made a course, an e-course. I said, what's an e-course? This is 20 years ago. And he says, online, he says, you send a course by email and people will pay $5,000. I said, Elsom, that is crazy. Nobody will ever pay to do a $5,000 course online. Boy, was I wrong. So about 6 or 8 weeks.
Puzzle, public speaking puzzle, the pieces.
Right? So everybody gets this, right? So it's like, in order to capture, here's the deal. So we did the e-courses to great audiences. I mean, huge audiences. 20, 30, 40 people going to an e-course at very, very high investment. But this is great. And Elsom taught me this too. When people invest in their life, like a real investment, like college or their wife or a child, something that's a huge lifetime investment, they tend to take it more seriously. And then they tend to pursue it with much greater intensity. This was one of Elsom's lessons for me. I felt very uncomfortable at first with this. But after time, I realized that the people who just saw something, they would read it or see a video or nowadays, and they would do nothing with it. But when people actually invest and they actually call Kevin and say, I say, so how's it going? Tell me what's happening. And they say, nobody ever says nothing, Kev, because that would make you happy. You know, they tell me precisely what's happening. Kev, I did this and this and this and this and this and this and this. And so, you do all the pieces. Yeah, go ahead.
Let me recap what's in my mind about pieces for public speaking to see if it looks like a list and you
do
anything to it, right? So number one, have a mentor, have someone to learn from that
for
has
sure.
to be not only very good professional, but it has to be a fit.
Yep.
For your
for real
this system. Number two, I picked up from your ideas is really know your material. Know your material.
That's this one, yep.
Make it really current. Don't leave it to old stories from
Correct.
Another century. Right?
Correct.
Number three, have something other than just a stage presentation, like an e-course, like an idea,
mm-hmm.
connect with audience beyond your presentation on stage.
Correct. And because people, if they like you, it's sort of like a relationship, like a marriage, or a very, very good friendship. If people like you, they really do like you and they really will want to be with you and spend time with you and call you and talk with you. And here's the thing. I have people that listen to Kevin Hogan every single day in the car. They go to work and they come home. They go to work, they come home and they say, Kevin, what did you mean on CD number 41 in Science of Influence? I'm like, tell me. I have no clue. But this is it. And you have to give people a way to stay connected with you. And it has to be so good that they want to keep listening to you over and over and over and over. So
like
you have to get that good.